You never know what's going to be in store today, though.
What a big change for Chaos.
Honestly, I hope they can keep it up, because they definitely had a really rough season last season.
No matter what, I am very hyped for this squad, and I hope to see them continue on. We'll see what you guys think about it, though. And 65% going the way of Ents. And a reminder, during the Six Invitational qualifiers for Europe, Ents dropped. They were not able to move forward.
Quite a few big contenders dropped.
Yes. I think Vitality are still in the running. We will go through all those details later on. There's a lot of stuff to really digest with the amount of Rainbow Six that's been happening. Yeah, even for us, it gets a bit.
Yeah, keeping track of it.
Yeah. Close your mind.
It's nuts. Yeah.
All right. Plus. Well, we should be ready to head into our match. We'll remind you, it's Oregon between Chaos and, of course, their opponents of Ents. This is very interesting because Oregon is a map that Chaos really thrive on.
But that also makes them a known quantity to an extent. So, I mean, that's something Ents can work on.
Something to think about, you know, Clash, Monty, etc.
Shield play in general, I think, is still going to be a big thing this season. It doesn't work for everyone. There's definitely Monties that just struggle. We saw a bit of that yesterday in Latin America. They definitely had a lot of struggles with it, really trying to push that idea of using Monty. Didn't always work, but we'll see if that happens today. I do think Chaos have always been very good at shields in general, especially the renewals, for example, on the Monty is quite the beast. And there's a Thatcher Ban. This is, again, becoming very common on Oregon, and of course, usually leading to a mute ban, so that is something that is going to reduce that pick rate.
Mm-hmm.
But we'll see if that happens. That is going to be, of course, up to Chaos to do that.
Well, the second attacker will be removed is Ying, so Chaos will take that away. Of course, Valkyrie is also an operator that gets banned quite a bit.
Definitely a strong possibility, although Echo, I think, also a good candidate. So it could be a mute Echo. Oh, Mira going to go instead. So, that means, I mean, I can't see Ents banning their own mute here. But if they were planning on mute being banned anyways, I guess can't hurt. But there's the Echo ban. So this is going to be interesting for the Laundry Hatch. So, for those of you not aware what the Thatcher ban has to do with this, is being able to stop the hatch in the lobby just above Laundry, just above that sink especially, is very difficult to deal with if there's a double mute going on there, because it's hard to get it, especially ex-Kairos, in a position where they can do that, especially since the changes where it required a minimum amount of ex-Kairos to open a hatch because of the damage stuff that was introduced with Maverick. So it becomes very tricky, and Laundry going to be the very first place they're going to play it, and there is that mute coming out from Wilkie. I have to imagine they expected it, but at the same time, then they won't know which operator gets switched for. And there we go. That is going to be the thing to help deal with the hatch. Maverick can start to open up part of the hatch, shoot the mute jammers, and that can make it easy for Habana to do it. Although if Maverick wants to, I suppose he can continue his job. But that seems a lot riskier to do.
Yeah, I mean, we've gotten it down to a certain science where it takes around 2.5 charges to destroy a hatch. I believe we were talking about that for quite a bit. My trials, even when Maverick was released, you could get around that. We saw that in Latin America as well a couple days ago.
Yeah. He's become a very consistent play for Latin America and starting to become one for all the regions, it seems.
He's a pick where, you know, you can if you want some extra bit of Heart Breach, but not enough to really, how do you say, destroy full bits of equipment, that's fine. You just want to destroy a hatch and then have some flexibility on walls or maybe another hatch where you would use utility on it. That's okay. If anything, on this map in Oregon, you can just run the Habana and you'll be fine anyways. Now, Shot is going to be even destroying the wall into meeting, which is a bit interesting. Usually that wall is reinforced, but I guess the mindset of Ents now on the defense is, you know what, we're going to give Chaos a hard time and delay them as much as possible before they can actually do anything on the site itself. And Gonfi is going to move around. The Ash is repelled right next to him here on the wall. Vitaline just peeking in. This is your standard play if you're attacking on this site or really anything. Destroy the wall from the small tower and keep moving into the kitchen. Particularly, we'll find the first one. Shot will go down, and that's a huge pick on the Maestro. I think he was still setting up here.
Definitely did seem like they caught him off guard. I mean, usually the Maestro is not going to be too far off position unless he is doing that, so it makes sense. That is an unfortunate start because he is so important in the late game, especially in clutch situations.
Yeah, I really hope that he had already set up at least his Evil Eyes because, man.
Hopefully he at least rotated them if need be too.
Especially since you have to deal with Red Groves playing the Capitao in this case. It's just not an easy position for you to be in. Now, Gonfi He's going to get flashed here by the Ash. Runs away for a bit, but Redgrove is ready to dive run on top of him. So Gonfi's going to try to do the damage. He's on the floor. He sprays right into him, but can't find the kill just yet. Redgrove is only down as Crips will get the finisher. Gonfi's been taken out. Slubbin will take some extra bit of damage, but secretly as well on fairly low HP. There's a lot of damage here being exchanged between two teams in the early game skirmish, but Redgrove will at least be picked up, and the advantage now two players up in Chaos.
They're definitely setting up at this point for kind of a retake position. Because they can't be holding that room anymore, they are set up in a good place to be able to go for a smoke plant. Although they have two of the players down at half health, Redgrove being important to get that smoke down. And then in this case, the Habana with the Diffuser very low on health, actually below 50% now. Mm. That is going to be difficult. Might want to hand that Diffuser off to someone else just because of the difficulty, especially with C4.
Yeah, the Maverick had opened up just a bit on the hatch. That's why you saw the shotgun there being used to fire into it. Now, the shotgun pellets, you know, they open up in a certain way, so you can use that to your advantage. Now, Oh no, Wilkie. And even
you rarely see that destroying the Evil Eye with the blowtorch.
Yeah, actually, that is definitely something I've never seen before. Slepin is gonna try to come in from behind. He'll find the kill on Redgrove. There's still one in the kitchen. Sprays all the way in the back, but not enough to finish off the player still holding on to the rotation. Slepin will have to dive down into the site now, downstairs, the laundry, to help out Boonsie. One more of these remote gas canisters, toxic babes, as Mr. Parker would like to call them.
Well, they have no smoke now from the Capitao, so this could actually work out for Ents.
Yeah, this is the last canister that they had. Boonsie will use this to advance just a bit and encroach onto the territory of the attacking team. 4v1 now, as now they can definitely dive onto Boonsie. They'll try to find the shots as Crips is now low on health and no diffuser has been set. You can hear it being put down right by on a machine, but Crips will be the one to finish things off. Boonsie will go down in Chaos. Efficient attack. I have to say, with every passing round that I watch them from play days 1, 2, and now in 3, they just seem to become this team that is just unstoppable. They are reveling in the chaos that Ents are trying to create for them, but that's exactly where they thrive.
Yeah. I mean, it was good coordination. You're seeing I think that's the strength of the team right now. You're seeing so much better coordination, and you can see it in the attack on the white stairs, right? You saw the push up failing to hit the Jaeger, so guess what? Dash comes flying in the window to do the damage as well because they've got him pinched at that point. Yeah, he did get down, but he got picked back up as well. But a lot of credit to Slebin for doing a good job holding the meeting hall. You saw how many angles he was having to fight at once. You know, you mentioned the wall being opened in the kitchen. He's fighting up top of the ladder. He's fighting through the hole into the kitchen. He's worried about his back as well. But you saw him just pretty much 360-ing around, trying to defend himself, and then still escaping. So
that's the super power play
to him. Absolutely.
He can do it all.
It's unfortunate it was maybe too little too late at that time, and a lot of that comes down to Shate dying early, unfortunately, and I would hope and expect that would not be the case this round. We might see a little bit better defense, but it is going to be on a different bomb site.
Now, to add to that, I'm not sure if Shate got shot through like a drone hole or something, or I don't know, explain Maestro in the meeting, and I don't know how he got shot so easily in the meeting hall, but I wonder maybe it was the fact that the wall was unreinforced from the lobby into the meeting hall, and that allowed for a quick wall bang, or from the kitchen directly through it. Now, again,
you know, a lot of possibilities.
Yeah, we don't have a direct replay system to see all of that. That'd be a definite dream come true, but still, Ents will change things up. Their logic behind this is, you know what, let's just go to another site. We don't really want to deal with playing the bottom floor again in laundry. But what's important now for Chaos is that they clear army, they clear the tower. If there's anybody in there, at least drone it, and so they know where to expect their opponents. There's nobody in the armory, so an easy play here for Crips to come in. There's a Habana available, which means probably Secrets is going to come in and use one of his sets of Exiros in here. If not, then the entire attack is going to focus on the opposite end of the map, or at least on the room opposite of Crips here, which allowed him to just move into this small door to the garage area. It's a one tap.
It's a good strategy. If you don't have a sledge and you can get up against it, absolutely. You do have Ash to take out the more long range one, but you might as well use that because you're not gonna need a lot of that blowtorch. You don't need the full thing or all five canisters of it. So
I mean, speaking of blowtorch, they can, you know, instead of using the Habana on the armory, they can still use the Maverick. So everything's available. Vitaline from below though, because he's taking control of the schoolyard here, or the school itself, he can just start doing damage, but he's got to be careful with Wilkie. Now, the call has come in, and there was no mute jammer to jam the call that the Dokkaebi of Redgrove had launched in. And Redgrove is actually an excellent Dokkaebi, one of the best in Europe, in my opinion. Yeah. Just Vitaline peeks in, but no kill to be found so far. Say that secretly will be yet again the one to find the kill, and this time on Shotgun again.
This is definitely not boding well for Entz. Just losing him continuously early on, specifically the operator and role that he plays. It's really problematic, but this again, this is a very coordinated attack. You see the droning coming out from both other players for the Ashe, as well as the Ashe himself for the attack.
Look at the amount of players downstairs. Chaos are going to try to use that to their advantage. They already have taken control of the generator, and secretly just dives in and gets the kill. Slepin will at least take down Renewals, but might be a bit too late here, as Chaos have already taken control, and Vitaline will find the last one. Scripps will get two for his own, and Chaos just watching angles and... just wait till Ents dive into them, because the instant they lost that Tau Flora control, there was no one to watch the White Stairs, and that was it. They lost the Maestro, who was playing inside of Generator. He got shot out from the window. And after that, there was only one other player still on the site. Once the drones came in from Chaos, a very efficient droning, I have to say, they got the information on the one player playing in the kids' bunks, and he just dove in. The Habana got the kill, and that's all she wrote, really.
It was definitely something that almost felt like a more aggressive Vitality. Like, they were still willing to hold angles and good coordination of droning to pinch people out. But at the same time, it was much more efficient and quick in terms of their execution, in terms of catching players individually, as opposed to waiting for them the entire time to come into them.
And that was a scary thing. Back in the day, like a year or so ago, when we talked about Vitality and the way that they played, the only thing we can say that was negative about them is how slow they were on the offensive. And it seems like Chaos have taken that and just refined it to a level where executions are hyper-reliant on efficient droning, and that's what they got. It's, I mean, this is just a Chaos on a completely different level. And Ents are not really able to find an efficient way to deal with them. Now, in both rounds, I want to say, losing that anchor of the Maestro, Shate, definitely does not help your case if you're Ents. We'll see how they change things up here as they'll play yet again downstairs in the laundry. Of course, they lost the first time, and then they promptly switched to the kids' dorms.
Yeah, we'll see. This is their second time. I think they were kind of deciding which bomb site will work better for them, trying the dorms right after. I mean, the dorms' defense of it, even when they were playing laundry, seemed to be something that was lacking. So trying to play dorms again just did not seem like the right call, because the attack top floor seems very efficient. Shate, though, again, playing very aggressive. So this is him potentially getting himself killed again. I mean, he's not in a bad position, but look at this pinch coming out from the Ashe as well. He's going to get stuck in a position here where he cannot fight the angles efficiently enough, or the drones coming to identify exactly where he's at for potential wall bangs. You could potentially see flashbangs come out from Crypts as well to blind him. I feel like he's going to be much better served on site here, because, well, he hasn't been able to do anything the last two rounds in a row. Dying again early, not going to help. I mean, Slebin definitely seemed much more efficient in there. Shate, though, at least defying it a little bit. Hopefully he doesn't get caught on this reload, but he did at least take down the Maverick, which should make it, in theory, a lot harder to get that laundry hatch open.
Now, of course, he has the 410 Bailiff secondary shotgun, so he can use that to open the hatch right in front of him and then dive down, but still has to worry about the entryway into the tower. Gomfy has set himself up in the kitchen. Again, this is something we see also a ton of on Border, and Gomfy will get one, secretly will refrag onto Shate as Gomfy's pushed back into the dining hall, and we'll have to go back up to the dormitory, and this actually will slow down the attack quite considerably. Now, what Ents really like doing is using operators that are usually anchors in positions where there's a lot of soft walls and they can use rotation holes to very quickly peek and get a kill or information and then fall back in. You see this a lot on Border when they're playing, oh, nicely done. Wilkie gets one on secretly, but again, back to it. On Border, when they're usually playing in the archives, they'll have a rotation hole to play into the office. And this is something similar here that we see for Tower. Now, the Jaeger peeks in, and even with the call, Vitaline kind of not there for it. Red Goof will respond. Take down Gomfy, but is it too late?
Definitely a much better round here for Ents. I mean, Shate did still die, but the fact that he got an important kill early on, I think, kind of stumped them a little bit in terms of how they were going to be able to progress from there. But again, walking into a lot of fire, it seems like Ents are getting a better read on how these attacks are coming down from Chaos, and that's offering the ability to actually counter it instead of walking into Chaos's trap. So we could see things shift around a little bit. I mean, this game has become a little more defender-sided, but that shot with the SMG 12 of all things, nicely done from Red Groove. And the better you are as a Dokkaebi player, the better you can pull that off. But didn't look behind him, and Wilkie shotgunning him right in the back, unfortunate for him. not a whole lot he could do about that because, well, I don't think he had any logic bombs left to be able to find out where he was at. Didn't have any drones left to do anything. Just what can you do at that point? Just hope you can run in and spray. I mean, you're stuck with a DMR and the SMG-12. If you can't control the SMG-12, you've got to be very aggressive to make sure that recoil isn't going to make you miss.
Now, this is why Wilkie actually plays quite a bit of Dokkaebi for ends on the attacking side. Runs CZ-75 instead of the SMG-12 just because it's a bit easier to control. It's just, it is quite easier to control. The only thing is that the iron sights bob around quite a bit.
It kicks up in your face. It's hard to see.
Yeah, that's the thing. Unfortunately.
I mean, compared to a normal pistol, I feel like a normal pistol is much more controllable in terms of being able to fire especially once they made the changes to the recoil so that it wasn't kicking as much in your face. The CZ, though, on the other hand, it's very tricky to use those iron sights. I have to say, you really got to be used to it. Whereas people who can control the SMG-12 fairly well are in, I think, a little bit of a better position.
Yeah, the only thing is that the CZ-75 actually, like the, how do you say it? The actual, like, thing above, it reciprocates in a way where the sights themselves are moving, whereas with other weapons, they stick to their own position and everything below them moves, or it's a mechanism inside of the weapon. That's why it seems a bit odd when you fire it compared to everything else, even though theoretically the recoil is fairly controlled. But
yeah,
hence now we'll go back up to the dormitory and we'll see how they change things around. There's already Shate maneuvering and setting up his rotation holes. Now, what a lot of people will do with Evil Eyes as well is there's the the shelves right in at the end of the hallway. They'll impact them and try to put an Evil Eye there. It's a pretty good position to be in, especially if you have extra shotguns, so you don't really have to worry about destruction and worry about how you're going to use your impact grenades. Sledbender is going to get blown to smithereens. Virline perfectly played frag grenade here from the garage, and the armory is yet again clear.
Well, Goffy about to get into a battle here. Red Groove checking his drone, but there we go. Goffy now caught out. He's going to be tough position because he's got to escape via the hallway or just stick his position. He's actually going to play it overly aggressive. Could catch him right here. Unfortunately, the timing, that's just going to trick him. This is really putting Red Groove in a tough spot because he has to fight this. Fortunately, gets away. And that is most of his health gone. And he's very important to make sure that this could go down as he's going to be there for the smokes potentially, but he's also still got one logic bomb left. So, it seems like a lot of stall out here. That one grenade kill, though, on Slevin, that is going to be something that will give them some advantage. But Ents just not peeking things poorly this time. But a flank from Renewals.
How is he still alive? Finally, Renewals. Oh, man. Finally, he'll get the kill. But that's now, you lose the Jaeger, you lost the Legion before he could do anything with his Ku Mines and Shate. He'll find the kill. What? Wait, what? How is the Habana even inside of the bunks?
Definitely, they are taking control of this very quickly. But that slows down Krups. Ooh, nice pinch on it. He's getting a little predictable in his attacks as well.
Wilkie just moving in from the attic there, and I'll get a kill. Easy one, actually, there. The SMG-11, 3v3. An advantage in health is the way of ends. So, also, drones from Chaos are going to be a bit more difficult to run around here just because of the mute jammers that were set up by Wilkie. And Shate, of course, with the 81-round box magazine on that Alda 556. Definitely something you have to worry about. Now, will White Stairs be relegated, or the control of it be relegated to Chaos? That is something only time will tell. Vidaline is still afraid of the position of Wilkie, but Nitro Cell will get used, and shotgun in hand, he's going to try to shut down anybody moving through the hallway. There is a hole. I'm not sure if you can vault through that here, but Vidaline can definitely move on in. Oh, no, Red Groove, he finds the headshot. Bucci just peeks in and instantly gets taken out. Vidaline with one more onto Shate. And unfortunately, Wookie does not have C4. He has to guide himself using pure audio.
Attackers are activating.
Unfortunately, the defuser will go down. Now, Wilkie has to go back and play the retake. There's already someone waiting for him in the hallway. In the instant he peeks, the Maverick of Renewals will find him, and Wilkie will go down. Chaos. They had an advantage, lost it, and then instantly brought it back. And I want to say, the Dokkaebi was just trying to destroy the boarding on the window. And yet Bunsi got tapped right through it. What an unfortunate series of events.
Yeah, that is definitely something that seems to be happening a lot to Ents here. They seem to be getting caught off guard by a lot of these plays. I mean, I liked what Gonfi was trying to do, but again, that was a good demonstration of that coordination there. Once Red Groove was in a tough spot, started losing a bit of health, guess what? Along comes his teammate, starts with the flank on the door, and that's exactly what needed to happen. Unfortunately, Gonfi, overly dedicated. That's the only problem with being on the west side, especially as a defender. You've pretty much got nowhere to go but back into towards the site. So he was pinched off at that point. Although, had he bailed earlier, might have been a little more helpful, because you're only going to do so much to control that and stop the Dokubi, because guess what? Defender, you can, you know, they can repel, they can rotate around attack via the roof. You're not really doing as much to them as you would like. Yeah, you're controlling the west tower there, but it is not going to give you as much as you would like if they could pinch you. And I appreciate his dedication to it, but it definitely did not work out in the end. And just a lot more picks towards the end. They can a fair amount of control of that top floor despite losing Crips even on it. The Buck was able to also open up some nice angles. That nice diagonal he had going through the bedroom. We'll see though, they're going to go with Dining Kitchen, so they're maybe getting a little desperate at this point to find a site that works for them, because so far, Laundry on the second try is the only thing that they've been able to win. So this is a... is the sort of wild card desperation Hail Mary play that's leaving Ents in a tough spot in a meta that is seemingly mostly defender-sided right now. So
one thing I want to applaud for Chaos is how active they've been. At least I'm not sure who their IGL is during these matches, but I want to say the preparation from the coaching staff was solid, and it shows in the calls here, just because it's been so efficient with the squad. Gonfi actually is going to find the first one. Vitaline is going to go down, so I don't want to scratch my own, you know, my own statement, but it still stands. Chaos have been able to adapt very efficiently to Ents just due to the way that, you know, their IGL is able to guide them around the map. Now, new jammers have been taken down. This is why you bring the Maverick as well. It makes things a lot easier for her to go through. You'll have to deal with, oh, let's go the other way and try to, you know, play against the enemy positioning, etc. You just break open the one hole, destroy any jammers that are in there, and that's all she wrote for that attack. And you see already Xyres have been used, ADS is being cleared, everything here for Chaos going well, and they just need to clear one more ADS, and there you go. That's all of them down. And they can move in and plant whenever they would like. They just need information and some sort of clear on those top bunks. There's that bulletproof camera that was set up by the Doc of Boonsi, which usually, who usually plays the smoke. This time he's playing the Doc, and obviously, it's for that extra bit of information, just to be able to deal with any smokes coming out from Chaos.
Well, they're in a decent position to go for the push, but it's going to be pretty predictable. But this stopping this plant is something that's very difficult to do. Unfortunately, Echo is banned, so you can't do anything about
the
C4 will, though.
The hallway wall is unreinforced, which is what usually you should be doing. But Chaos, even with three players, should be able to get this plant. The Maestro camera on the couch there. It's going to do quite a bit of work as one is down, and Gonfi will get one more. Crips the last one alive as Wilkie, there you go, will get the finisher on Red Groove. And Ents just immediately bounce and jump on the opportunity to take down Crips. This is why you never reinforce the sidewall. Always leave it open for C4s. And on top of that, just because also you can fight it from the top floor because of the hallway and the roof, basically, that can use to your advantage by shooting up a hole and just chucking a C4 through it. It'll hit right on the side, and even the wall is soft. It's got to be more than enough to kill a player that's behind the wall. And it was perfectly executed by Ents. That was well done. The instant they had the opportunity, dove right on in and cleared it up. The Maestro camera, I have to say, did way too much damage in that position, and it delayed the attackers just enough for all of Ents to rotate back and kill whoever was still there.
Well, I think at that point, you could pretty much say Chaos lost that round purely on the fact they didn't take showers. Defenders, that's what it came down to. Wilkie being allowed to live, because he was the only thing really to be able to stop the plant for the most part. Yeah, of course, you had the Maestro, that Evil Eye on the couch, that was able to do some damage and things like that to be able to deny, also to be able to see through smoke. But Wilkie's ability to hit that C4 is what made that work. I mean, he took a bit of damage in the process, but you have to expect it at that point, but that is a big part of Dining just not really being in the meta. So teams looking for opportunities, like you said, opening up that wall there, setting themselves up to be able to do something to counter, because you can't get around that corner in the dining room, because it's very easy once that wall is open to stop anyone from rotating from kitchen or the hallway in around through dining to the other side of the couch. because it just comes down to creative plays like that. I've got to imagine either taking showers in the future or just finding some other counters to be able to stop that will be a big thing. But that is the second dining defense we've seen be successful. We saw a double shield, deployable shield one, also successful recently. So maybe tower won't completely dominate third bomb site forever here, but Ents at least only one round behind now. They're not in the worst position, but still, losing as many rounds on defense as they have, not a great place to be, and they're going to have some really good attacks to make up for it.
Yeah, and of course, the best-case scenario for them here, for Ents, that is to tie it 3-3 on the half and then move into the second half with basically a reset and see how they can pull things off on their attacking side. Now, attackers have lost Thatcher, which doesn't really help when it comes to attacking the bottom floor, but you would expect, oh, Thatcher banned, it means Laundry is going to be an easier site to defend. Defender's going to stick around more often on the site itself, which is the opposite of what Ents actually did. So, interesting, but Vitaline loses his drone, but that's totally worth it, as Nitro Cell has been taken out, as well as Wilkie in the situation. Remind you, as far as we know, Gomfy is the in-game leader for Ents now, as Wilkie was in the past. So, bit less focus here for Wilkie and that sort of thing. Slabin will get taken down. Renewals from below. We'll find him. Gomfy is still upstairs as well, holding up in the kids' bunks. And just going to sit there with the Ella. I mean, definitely wants people to push into him. And the Goo Mines are going to give him some information. But he's got to be careful. There's 2-3 speeds converging on his location. And the grenade from below locks them down. Vitaline will find it again. Grenades have been on point. And suddenly, Bunsen and Shate are the last two alive. You're defending the Laundry, and there's so many bodies put elsewhere. Nobody's able to rotate. The grenades are perfect. The calls, everything wonderful here. And Ents will just have to deal with two more players.
Torches go.
Well, three more players against them in this situation. And the jammer should get taken down. Renewal's got to be careful.
Not as easy as you'd think it would be. Definitely people are prepared to counter it when they know that that's going to be a strategy. And he's on very low health. If they could just peek him, but just only having two people, I mean, an Evil Eye at this point could kill him.
A bomb has been located.
Yeah, with a couple taps, the Evil Eye, that should be more than enough, and renewals will have to fall back. Now, the amount of time Chaos have right now, they can definitely go for a reset. And you might be thinking, oh, why is nobody taking destroying the hatch? Well, you need to destroy the mute jammer below it, guys. So that's basically the thing you have to worry about. Grenade is going to get thrown into the back, and fortunately, there for the smoke of Boonsi. He doesn't take damage from that, but he'll get shot down instantly by the Buck. Which you don't get the confirmation of the drop.
Attackers recovered the defuser.
There's still something you have to watch out for, and Shate gets shot from the side as the Ash just dives on down. Crips will find the kill, and that's a 4-2 at the half advantage for Chaos. The Swedes in control of the match.
Definitely not working out so well for Ents. And I got to admit, I mean, I was a little concerned coming into day three that Chaos couldn't keep up the pace they'd started the season with, but they absolutely have been doing that. I mean, we'll see now that sides switch, things might not work out the same way for them, but attack is generally more difficult these days, especially with that Thatcher ban there. That should have given a huge advantage to Ents. The fact that they played Laundry three times and were only able to win it once with meat available and no Thatcher, it really makes me concerned here. They're going to have to play a very serious, efficient attack to make this work, starting off dorms instead of Laundry as well, which is curious given the fact that, well, Laundry has the biggest advantage, but maybe they want to start on maybe the secondary site, see how well that goes, maybe get the point, and then switch right on to, in theory, the better site. Crips, you can see, along with Vitaline, doing quite a good job. And I was talking about Vitaline being a little shaky before. Seems like he might have found his groove a little bit better today.
The grenades have been on point.
Yeah.
And really, people are going to look at this and they're like, wow, he's really good at timing those grenades. True, but how is he able to do those? There was a question today that was put up on Reddit, and I really want to highlight this and try to find a solution to it. And both of us here together, definitely. People are asking, you know when a fragger is doing well just because you look at the scoreboard and it's there. How do you know when a support player is doing well? Now, in my opinion, when the fragger is able to put up so many frags on the board and the team is able to chain rounds together, this means the support player is doing what they're supposed to do, and that's the thing. That's why you can't really show the support player in their prime unless you're talking about Goku.
It certainly helps, depending on the operators, to be able to identify gadget usage as well and how their ability to hold their spots. So if you're talking about defense, for example, how well can they hold their area of map control? How long can they delay there? Things like that. That's something you can identify. And we have things like cost as a stat to try and help identify things like that, but it's certainly not something that's going to be displayed on screen on the scoreboard. It is down to identifying, are people getting kills? Are people playing objectives? Are people surviving the round? Or are people at least trading? Those are those stats. That's what those mean, but those are our identifiers of that. But there's also other things. Like I said, are they holding their rooms? Are they droning for their team?
And of course, you know, some of the cool stats that maybe we can have one day. That is a dream. Like, how much damage does the smoke do with his canisters? And, you know, mostly a support player that's playing on a site. You can at least tell, okay, well, he's delaying, he's using his utility in this certain way. Well, now it's understandable how his role really has been showing up for the squad. Secretly, we'll find one on Chate. As in the meantime, Enst will try to open up into, well, from the tower into the attic. But nobody's really watching the windows, and unfortunately, that's the diffuser on the floor in a very open position there. So if there's any information that Chaos can get here, this can really snowball for the Swedes.
It's definitely going to have to be the case where the Capitan might even have to use a smoke on the window just to be able to recover that diffuser safely, because the angles from that window can be tricky to deal with, especially if there's ACOGs on defense, which there is. So.
There is one available, and Redgrove, of course, playing the Pulse, which will give information, but there's a player as well in the kitchen. And Secretly can just wait until Renewals gives him some info. You can see Renewals, who's on his cameras right now, and Secretly will dive on down, but Slebin is ready. And that rappel was the perfect bait there. 4v4, the 57-second mark. Enter taking their sweet time here, as they are very, very careful to tread as slowly as possible against Chaos here, who appear to be extremely prepared.
Unfortunately, losing that diffuser early on definitely hindered a lot of time spent, but they are going to be setting up for a kid's room take. It looks like you got the smokes coming out into the crossbow from Wilkie, but they might be telegraphing that a bit too much with the repels. Redgrove definitely reading into Gompy's attack there.
No information here for Enz, as Wilkie and Slebin will get down instantly. Bunchy, last man alive, so he walks in the hallway, and that's the cleanup. Chaos, four players left alive. They demolish Ents in this round. And clear thing that you can see here, Chaos, when they were on the attack, the drones were beautifully efficient. They were getting information and they're able to follow up. There's always drones in front of the attacking players or above them that are basically allowing them to do what they were doing, grenades or, you know, frags or holding flanks, etc. For Ents, not the case at all. Very, I guess it's fairly simple to spot in this situation.
It's definitely them just not really. I mean, when you have a bad start like that on defense, too, that's definitely going to impact your attack rounds, just because confidence is more important sometimes for attack than it is for defense, because with defense, you can really kind of play back and play off information a little bit, work a little bit more on just coordinating defenders where they are information-wise. I mean, you have a little bit less information in the sense that you're dependent on some of the cameras that you've set up or the pulse that they're playing in Chaos, things like that. But at the same time, the attackers need that confidence that you saw from Chaos coming out, especially those initial rounds when they really were on point. The coordination benefits from that, and the communication as well. And that's one of the things you can't see on screen, is how much communication benefits from players winning their rounds. Because as you start losing rounds, communication does tend to break down between teammates. They start losing their ability to call things crisply and clearly, to stay on top of what they need to be communicating, as well as just sort of that subtle sync you get with your teammates when you're really kind of in that groove that you get, you know, especially when you see common pairs, you know, players that work really well together. They kind of read into what each other's going to do. In this case, just it's not working out for Ents so much this time. We're seeing a lot of them kind of playing individually and not that high level of coordination that's calling out things to stop some of the plays that are coming out from Chaos. And it's absolutely working. Chaos just well coordinated. I got to imagine Ents maybe going to have to work on that after this match.
Oh, yeah. This is just Chaos on a completely different level. And it's difficult to quantify how the one change, Snooken no longer on the squad, was exactly what the team needed. Now, from what I'm told, Secretly is the IGL. We'll have to verify that in the interview if Chaos end up winning this matchup, but still, I'm very curious to see how the calls are going on here for Chaos. In the meantime, Ents taking their time. They're still adamant on this push from the tower side. There's nobody from construction just yet. They still have to worry about Secretly, who's quickly dispatched by Slebin. Well played here on the IQ. They don't have to worry about an Echo, but still, Crips. tie it up instantly on a Gomphy. You lose the Maverick here, who's not really an important operator, but it does allow you some flexibility just in case you want to start pushing from the opposite end of the map by the lobby side and not just from the tower.
Yeah, the tower push is going to be fairly one-dimensional at this point, which is going to put a lot of pressure on the smoke as well as the mute with the C4. And then, of course, Pulse with C4 as well, although Pulse is most likely going to be on his heartbeat sensor calling out for the mute and the smoke first. But those Legion Goo Mines are also going to help with that. That's going to stall them out a little bit more, put them in positions where those C4s are more effective. But Crips, able to just hold the top floor here, is going to be a huge problem for them if they can't take him out, and they only have a minute 16.
Everybody from Ends just suddenly dives into the meeting hall. Now this is, okay, interesting. It seems like the push will happen here. Actually, this kind of doesn't make too much sense. So the Claymore is set in the back. One of the hatches in the meeting hall has been taken out, but you still don't have full control. It's odd that the push happens completely from tower, then goes into the lobby with thermite charge already been used on the meeting. It's just, I know they're kind of relying on having the Maverick as well, but in this case, they might just have to change their setup completely. And Vitalian is just ready. Two more gas canisters left for the smoke here as Red Groove will find one on Slubbin. Take down the IQ, and Shate goes down. Red Groove with the 2K. Yet again, the Pulse feeding information and feeding himself kills Nom Nom Nomming on Ents. Vitalian and Crips will get the last two, and Ents just absolutely demolished by Chaos.
Unfortunately, the bans that came out from Ents actually backfiring on them because they don't have the ability to take down those mute jammers. Mm-hmm. I mean, they were expecting the mute to be banned. Because of that, they were expecting to be able to deal with these attacks a lot more swiftly because Chaos were ready and, like, guess what? We don't care. We will make our attacks work regardless of your ability. I mean, yeah, it didn't always work out for them, but the fact that it worked out often enough actually completely backfired into strategy.
One thing I want to focus on specifically what you said. Oh, the Thatcher is banned. You should probably ban the mute. Well, Chaos, when they were attacking, they're like, we'll just play the Maverick. This is what Ents are doing here. Difference is, when Chaos were on the attack, they would give the Maverick instant control of the lobby to try and work things after deleting any player that's on the top floor. Ents make it difficult for themselves by pushing in from the tower every single time. And now Chaos are going to play the tower. So the Maverick kind of just is there. And I don't know how much work he's going to be able to do on this site specifically, just because tower has so many ways of playing it, just because, and on top of it, it's basically if you take a site that is spread along the same floor and you just flip it over. Just flip it 90 degrees, and this is what you get in tower. And T3 is just such an important part of it that Ents might finally have the opportunity to break through.
10 seconds to go.
Well, we'll see. They are on match point. If they don't break through now, it's over. Ents haven't had as good of a start this season as we would have expected. It's definitely been the Chaos show. This is something I don't think anyone would have predicted based off of the performance last time. And not all fairness to Snooken, there may have been a lot of other changes internally on the team as they readjusted to how they wanted to play things. But I got to say, kudos to them because it's absolutely working.
This makes me super excited for Chaos versus Empire. That's for sure.
Wow, why is he getting away? Was he on his drone?
I gotta imagine
he was on his drone at that point.
Oh no, Comfy.
And that is such a common peek too, taking out the bottom of the door like that. That is not something new. Boonsy had a 0 kills here, so far just not hitting his shots. It is, that confidence completely shot at this point. I feel like Ents may have just resigned this match mentally at this point. I mean, maybe not consciously, but it's what do you do against a tower attack? You're failing, and again, losing your Maverick right at the beginning of the round. I mean, he wasn't essential to the attack, but again, it's that kind of cascading effect of tilt that's just pervasive through the team. Slevin, though, at least trying to put some pressure on them here, but Boonsy just holding windows the whole time is not going to be effective in this, and there's not even a Valkyrie here, and there goes Wilkie.
Renewals again with another one on Shate. Slevin and Boonsy last two alive. You might be the superpower player, but you're gonna need some real Dragon Ball Z superpowers here to win it out. And I don't think Kaioken is gonna be enough. You're gonna need to go for that Super Saiyan 7 at this point, because references aside, this is gonna be super complex. And Vitalian finds the headshot as well from the bottom floor. No need to even hold on to T3. This was an oddity. an oddity of a game, especially on tower there, where just didn't matter. Hey, we don't have T3. That's okay. We can just fight you from the main floor.
Yeah.
Wow. Wow.
Again, it was the bad start by Ents continuing to snowball, and the fact that their strategic bans completely backfiring. It was not the best place to be in, because their tower takes to try and adapt. Oh, you know, hey, we can't do anything about the mute, so we'll set up for tower takes. Chaos completely read into that. It was just